Good morning, everyone. Good morning. If you are newer here, let me introduce myself. My name is Tara, and I am the Director of Connections and Community. And what that simply means is I get to welcome you and get to share with you of what we're going on here at Vintage Church and ways to get connected. So, hi. If you are newer and you would like more information about us, we try to make it super simple for you guys and not awkward. We put connection cards right in front of you. We provide a pin. You can fill out your information. We can email you, text you. And all you do is check the boxes of more information that you would like to know about. I promise you, we do not spam you. I simply just give you what you would like to know more about. And then also to make it a way for you to feel welcomed, if you turn it into the kiosk, we have a gift for you. Here at Vintage Church, we're about supporting local businesses. And so we actually have a gift card for you to go and enjoy a coffee or a tea at Inspire Coffee downtown in Lodi. It's a great place, a great environment, and we want to support them. Also, we wanted to make it very simpler for you guys. We put up a new connection corner. We're calling it Rooted at Vintage Church. And so if you're kind of going, what do you guys do here? What ministries do you guys have? Right there in the corner, you will find information about Bible studies, men and women, ways to serve. You can see how we are involved in the ministry in Lodi, ways that you can jump in. And so there's several different cards there, Rooted, because here at Vintage Church, we really want to see people rooted in Christ, cultivated in community so that you can be fruitful in everyday lives. And so we want to do that practically through the different ways here at Vintage Church.
Did you mention pizza with the pastor?
I didn't, because you didn't have my announcements here. So we also here at Vintage Church, we like to eat, and that is something that you will find out about us. And so a way to kind of get to know us, Timothy and I personally, and our staff, we invite you to pizza with the pastor. So if you want to really know who we are and our story, come and have lunch on us, and that is coming up.
Where
is
the date? September 29th.
September 29th. And so if you'd like to register, there's actually a card in our Rooted corner called Pizza with the Pastor. You just register, or you just come by and tell me, hey, I will see you September 29th and enjoy some pizza on us.
And then today is a day of stories, feasting, and gratitude. It's going to be an amazing day, and that means after service today, we're feasting.
Yay.
Did you smell the tri-tip coming in?
It is going to be amazing.
We have a baked potato bar, salad, and an amazing dessert bar from all of our amazing bakers here at our church. It's really going to be a great day. So we encourage you to stick around after service. Go head down to the fellowship hall and see what God has done. We even have a slideshow in our Old Vine Cafe. And so it's going to be a great day. And I do want to plug this. On September 23rd, if you're interested, Pat and Janae Schumacher are going to be leading Financial Peace University in our Old Vine Cafe. There's more information in your bulletin. And then I'm really excited about this. Next Sunday, we're starting a new series in the book of Daniel called Planted in Exile. We'd love for you to join us. We're going to ask some really great questions for the kind of just cultural moment that we are in. And then lastly, if you look in your bulletin, there's a list of the projects that we've done around here in our revitalization efforts. Really, today is a day of celebrating the first fruits of what God has done here at Vintage Church. We'll tell you more about the story as we progress. But as you see all of those projects, you can see we've been busy. And it feels like even the last few months, we've been busier. And so I just want to say thank you. As I was stayed up till midnight last night working on the slideshow, and I was looking over the last few years, I realized my kids were small when we moved here. And they were different, and I had a mustache, and it was just all this weird stuff. And you're going, oh, man. And I just want to say thank you to a few people. Thank you to my wife first. As you will hear in my story and her story, before we moved to Lodi, we were kind of in a season of rest and figuring out what God had for us. And it was kind of God prompting her that provoked me to go back into ministry, and God opened the door for us to come to Lodi. And so I just want to say thank you for her tireless service and support and prayers and encouragement. and I couldn't do it without her. And then also, I just want to say thank you, special thank you to my 5 kids. When we got here, there was about 23 senior saints, and we were 7 people that were younger than everyone else, and my kids were the youth group. And honestly, they served, they helped me with video, they served in kids ministry, they helped clean up bushes and sweep dirt. And I just want to say thank you to my kids. And then I also want to say thank you to Marvin and Jen. Jen has been in, and her family has been in the kitchen cooking the tri-tip and getting all the baked potato. Marvin has been helping tirelessly with all of the different projects. And so I just want to say a special thank you to Marvin and Jen. I want to say a special thank you to Evan and Olga. If you didn't know, for 2021, we had YouTube videos. We didn't have a band or anything like that. And then God provided and brought Evan, who I knew from a previous church, and now we have a full band, and we're super thankful for that. I want to say thank you to Darlene and all of her amazing team and volunteers and all of the baking and hospitality that they do. Yes. I want to say thank you to Debbie Cricket and JD, our hospitality, our Sunday morning hospitality team, for setting up coffee every Sunday and just being awesome. And then I also want to say thank you, special thank you, it looks amazing, to Wendy, Steve, and Cassie. They did all of the great balloon decorations and everything, and the arches, and they're the ones that lasered all of the hats and everything in our cafe, and it looks amazing. Yeah. Special thank you to Jesus, Heidi, and Debbie, our kids workers who are back there working today. And then I don't know if she made it because she was sick, but thank you to Denise Rivera, who has been leading the charge in prayer for the last 30 days and hitting the neighborhood with door hangers. And so I just want to say again, thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone who's donated, supported, volunteered, and helped us, because really only together by the grace of God we can make Jesus irresistible in everyday life. And so if you do want to give or support our mission or contribute what we're doing here today, our giving box is actually in the lobby. And you can give outside those doors, or you can give online, Venmo, or the Tithely app. But as we transition to worship, we have some videos of stories. I'm going to share a little bit, and then we're going to end with communion and just have a great day feasting in the fellowship hall in the cafe. But as we prepare our hearts this morning, we've been kind of meditating on a Psalm 107. In the first 3 verses, it says this. It says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." And it says, "Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story." And that's really why we've gathered here this morning. We're going to tell our story, those that have been redeemed and rescued and renewed and restored. And it says, "Those he redeemed from the hand of the foe, those he gathered from the lands, from the east and the west, from the north and the south." And that's what we're here to do. And so I would invite you to stand and prepare your hearts to sing. And if you have been rescued and redeemed by the grace of God, would you say so today with your singing, with your clapping? And let's give thanks to the God for his grace and his steadfast love. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day that we can set aside to honor you and to celebrate the grace of God. And so we just ask that you would be honored for the fruit here. Apart from you, we can do nothing. But if we abide in you, we can abound with much fruit. And so we ask, Lord, that you'd be glorified and honored. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Let's stand and let's sing this morning.
To our eyes, who is the love who will abide? Only Jesus, only Jesus, who is true as light. Only Jesus Christ, only Jesus, only Jesus, who is lifted high. Only Jesus Christ, who is the purpose of our days? Who is our hope that doesn't fade? Who is our courage and our strength? Who is the fullness of our faith? Only Jesus, only Jesus, who is lifted high. Only Jesus Christ, only Jesus, only Jesus, who is lifted high. Only Jesus Christ, only Jesus, only Jesus. Oh, come on, we sing, you are the way. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the blood, the water, the vine. You are the word, and you are the light. Only Jesus, only Jesus. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the blood, the water, the vine. You are the word, and you are the light. Only Jesus, only Jesus. Only Jesus, who is true is light. Only Jesus Christ, only Jesus. Only Jesus, who is lifted high. Only Jesus Christ. You are the way, the truth, and the light. You are the blood, the water, the vine. You are the word, and you are the light. Only Jesus, only Jesus. You are the way, the truth, and the light. You are the blood, the water, the vine. You are the word, and you are the light. Only Jesus, only Jesus. Amen. Your goodness, I would be desperate without your love. Slave to the darkness, if it wasn't for the cross. You have won me with your kindness. Chase me down when I was lost. Where would I be if it wasn't for the cross? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. 'Cause with your blood you bought my freedom. Oh, hallelujah for the cross. Amen this morning, hallelujah, for the cross. Seen all my shame was met with mercy. Now your mercy will be my song. And all the glory, all the power of the cross. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. 'Cause with your blood you bought my freedom. Oh, hallelujah for the cross. And by your stripes I'm healed. And by your death I live. The power of sin has overcome. It is finished, it is done. By your stripes I'm healed. And by your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished, it is done. By your stripes I'm healed. And by your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished, it is done. By your stripes I'm healed. And by your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It's finished. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. 'Cause with your blood you bought my freedom. Oh, hallelujah for the cross. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. 'Cause with your blood you bought my freedom. Oh, hallelujah for the cross. We thank you for the cross, Jesus. We thank you for the cross. Oh. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. 'Cause with your blood you bought my freedom. Oh, hallelujah for the cross. Crucified in you, we're raised from death to life. We sing Christ and Christ crucified. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We sing Christ and Christ crucified in you, we're raised from death to life. Crucified, hallelujah, hallelujah. See, death couldn't hold you down. Hell couldn't steal your crown. There's resurrection power in your name. In your name, let all the earth cry out. Lift up a holy sound. Give all the glory now.
Come on, this Jesus is the gospel name, that we're singing
Jesus
this morning.
Name. Death couldn't hold you down. Hell couldn't steal your crown. There's resurrection power in your name. In your name, let all the earth cry out. Lift up a holy sound. Give all the glory now to Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Death couldn't hold you down. Hell couldn't steal your crown. There's resurrection power in your name. In your name.
On the earth cry out.
Lift up a holy sound. Give all the glory now to Jesus' name. Jesus' name. We sing Christ and Christ crucified in you. We're raised from death to life. We sing Christ and Christ crucified. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We sing Christ and Christ crucified in you. We're raised from death to life. We sing Christ and Christ crucified. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We sing Christ and Christ crucified in you. We're raised from death to life. We sing Christ and Christ crucified. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Amen, church. Amen. I'm going to pray in just a moment, but I want to read something this morning out of Ephesians chapter 2. At the end of the service, we're going to be singing a song called Made Alive. It's right out of this section of scripture, and this is what Paul writes to the church in Ephesus. He says, "You were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind." That's the bad news this morning. But the good news, the gospel this morning, is in verse 4. "But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved." You see, why do we sing in church? I know a lot of people may ask that question. Why do we sing in church? We sing our story. We sing our story. I don't know about you, but this morning I'm reflective and I've been thinking about when I was dead in my sins and trespasses. I'm thinking about the areas of my life that were dead and broken. And I'm thinking about the grace of God this morning, because the real hero of today is the grace of God. It's by grace we've been saved. It's by grace we've been redeemed. It's by grace we've been revitalized. It's by grace we've been restored to fellowship with God. It's by grace shame has no longer any hold on us. It's by grace there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. It is the grace of God. And my prayer for us this morning is that we would experience grace upon grace upon grace. Would you pray with me this morning? Father, we thank you for the grace of God. Undeserved, unmerited blessing and favor, love. Thank you. We couldn't earn it. We couldn't chase it down, but you pursued us. The hound of heaven pursued our rebel hearts and captivated us with your beauty and your grace. And so, Lord, we just come this morning and we simply say thank you. Thank you. And may our songs tell our story. May the redeemed of the Lord say so this morning. May we share our story of grace and mercy and beauty that's found in the cross, that's found in the eyes of our Savior. And so we just ask, Lord, that you'd be exalted this morning, that you'd be honored. It's all for you. It is all about you this morning, Jesus. And so we love you. We thank you for the grace of God. For those that come in here that are anxious or struggling or wandering or distressed or maybe even addicted or prisoners of something, Lord, we ask that you would meet them this morning And that you, Holy Spirit, would open up the eyes of their hearts, that they would know Christ and the power of his resurrection, that they would have eyes to see how great your grace is this morning, how amazing your grace is this morning. So be glorified in this place. And all God's people said, amen. Church, we've been welcomed freely by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we take this moment in our service to welcome one another as an act and an embodiment of that welcome and hospitality. So would you just take a few moments and shake someone's hand, introduce yourself, welcome one another. Vintage Kids, come on up. You have an amazing class for this morning. So come up with Mr. Jesus and Heidi. They're going to be leading you to class this morning.
If we could have everybody kind of make their way back. One thing you'll find about Vintage Church, if you're new here, is that we all really like to talk. My name is Marvin. I am the Director of Operations Ministry here at Vintage Church. And it is my absolute pleasure to be here this morning. I want to give a big thank you to all the volunteers this morning. I got here at 7 o'clock. I thought it was early, and there was already people here running around doing things, and I went, whoops. I'm going to introduce a video series that's coming up. Something that was really important to me when I decided to kind of have a life in ministry is that I wanted to make an impact in our community. And when I came to Vintage Church, it wasn't for that, but by God's grace, I was like, oh, that's what they're doing here. And I have been busy. Blessed busy the whole time since I've been here in the last 2 years, and it has been just an amazing journey. Before we start that video, I'm going to read a letter that one of our members wrote here. And he doesn't know this, but it's an absolute blessing for me to read this. He was the first person I really got to tell how amazing this church was. I had friends and people in town that I had told that I'm going to Vintage, I'm loving it, it's a great time, but this person particularly was the first person I really got to like look him in his face and be like, what you're looking for is here. And I started this new thing, I can't come up here without crying, so I don't know why. It's 3 weeks in a row every time it gets me. So I'm going to read this, and then we're going to share some other stories from our community here. It says, when I first came to Vintage Church, I truly did not know what to expect. At the time in my life was chaotic at very best. I was searching for answers, and I had no clue where to start. I still found that I had an idea of what I might see my first time attending. I expected your typical church-faring folk. I expected hymns. I expected sitting down and rising up, as well as refreshments after service. In all these regards, Vintage did not disappoint. It checked all the boxes you would want a church to check. What I didn't expect, and what still surprises me even now, is the love, the openness, and honest sense of family here. This church lives and breathes the love of Jesus in everything it does. It shares that love in every opportunity, openly and willing, with joy in their hearts. At our church, I have been welcomed with open arms and understanding hearts. I've experienced care and compassion, generosity and thoughtfulness. I have watched the light and love of Jesus living and working through every member of this church, in each of their own special ways. I have also had the great pleasure of seeing the love of the Lord exalted through all of you from the stage as a member of our worship team. It is such a great pleasure to have even a small role in everything that's happening here and is going to happen at Vintage Church. Thank you all so much for letting me be a part of this family. Thank you for helping me find the light, the love, and peace of our Lord and Savior. Our church has given me giving me a renewed life, and I could not be more grateful. Stephen Blankenship.
Some of you are familiar with my story. I grew up in church, and I began loving Jesus from a very early age, and I started reading the Bible for myself when I was a child. But when I was 9 years old, I began to be groomed by a trusted church elder. So when someone talks to me about being disenfranchised or disillusioned with the corporate church or the organized church, Christian church, I get it. I really do. And I can tell you that I have lived a lot of the horrors myself. I had a therapist recently ask me, why am I still a Christian given my history and what I've been through? And the answer is really simple. It's really generic. So I'm sorry that I can't go into more depth. I would like to, and if you would like me to take you out for a cup of coffee, I would love to just tell you of what the Lord has done in my life in more detail. But for the sake of time, the answer is Jesus. I truly, truly believe that Jesus was a man who was perfect. He was a perfect human being who walked this earth. And because I'm not perfect, he died in my place. And I truly believe in the resurrection. I truly believe that the Bible is real through and through. It does not contradict itself. And I've studied it. I spent my entire life studying it. And it's because of that. It's not because of who hurt me or what church did this to me, or my confusion of what justice is, or all of those types of things. It's because I know the true person who is the author of real peace and real healing. And from experience, I have experienced that healing. And if you're looking for a church or a community of people who's perfect, we're probably going to disappoint you. I'm just going to be honest with you. But any of us will tell you that Jesus will not disappoint you. When you really truly know him and you bring your questions, you bring your doubts, all of it's okay. And you bring it to him and you're going to find true peace that is beyond understanding. You're going to find real acceptance from him. And you're going to find a different way of looking at the world that will really bring true meaning into your life. And so I invite you to consider getting to know Jesus and consider being part of a family of believers, a family of Christians who will support you. And that's not, it's easy just to come to church on a Sunday and listen to a sermon and then go home. But it's hard to be vulnerable with people that could hurt you. And sometimes you have to be vulnerable and to trust in order to get all the benefits that a community can offer you. So that is my encouragement, and I hope that I get to talk to some of you, and just, I'd like to hear your story. I could tell you mine, and I hope to see you again.
I think even if I ever happen to go to another church, I think to me, vintage church is always going to be a special time in my life. And I say that because it's during the past 2, maybe 3 years that I've been at Vintage Church that I've experienced so much of the Lord's grace and kindness and mercy. You know, it started with just going to the sermons, and that evolved into attending the men's Bible study and being part of cohort, and now even leading the children's ministry. And just during my time here, the knowledge that the Lord has shared with me, and even beyond that, the truth that he has put into my heart has been so life-changing, just being able to experience his presence, being able to know him, and still to this day, and I imagine it will be so for the rest of my life, just continuing to know him and to try to understand him, even though it's so little, and just the freedom and the peace and just all the good things that come from getting to know the Lord. And so, yeah, I think when I think of how I've experienced Jesus during my time at Vintage Church, it's been so many things that have been so transformative.
Hey, Vintage Church, this is Tara here, and I have a story to share. You know, 6 years ago, if someone would have came up to me and told me that I would be back into full-time ministry and Timothy would be preaching, I probably would have laughed in your face and told you to get out of my way. You see, we experienced something in 2017 that wrecked us. Church hurt is very real, and I never, ever saw myself working in any type of ministry, let alone barely wanting to attend a church. But God was not done yet, and over the time of about a year and a half, he began to work on my heart, really slow and gentle. And Timothy wanted to do a Bible plan reading with our kids. And so of course I say yes, and I'm reading along, and out of nowhere, something just hits me. And the Holy Spirit just filled me up, and I began to sob at my desk at work. And I went to the stairwell and I just looked up to the heavens and I was like, Lord, I surrender. I surrender to you, and help me trust you again. And we began to attend a church, and slowly I began to serve there, very slowly, and I was okay with that. And then something miraculous happened again, and we were at a marriage group, and the Lord just looked at me, and I felt like through the teacher that I was teaching that he was talking right to me and talking about the gifts that God deposits in us and how it is for his glory and his glory alone, and that we don't want to get in the way of people using their gifts. And I just looked at my husband that night, and I looked at him, I said, "You're called. You are called to preach God's word and to preach the gospel, and I am not going to stand in your way, and I will come beside you." And 2020, we began a fast, again, surrendering ourselves to the Lord and just asking him, where are you sending us? And 5 days later, we get a Facebook message about Lodi Community Church, and the rest is history. And here we are, Vintage Church. I am one that can genuinely say I have been transformed by the Lord, and he has put me in a place in this community where I have witnessed his hands and feet love me, love my family, and I've got to see God use so many of you by healing you, restoring you, and setting you up into places that you were called to be for his glory. And so I want to encourage you that if you are here and you've experienced church hurt and it just took so much for you to get here, know that you're not alone. Know that we serve a God that is gentle and kind and loving and heals us from the inside out and then begins to send us for his glory and his glory alone. I am so blessed to be a part of this community, and I love you guys. I genuinely love my church. So thank you, Vintage Church, for being an amazing example of making Jesus irresistible in everyday life, because he really is.
Okay, so there were two questions asked. How have I experienced Jesus at Vintage? And the other kind of question option was, how have I experienced community here? And I can actually answer both of these. You know, before coming to Vintage, I had served on a worship team, a tech team as well, at another church in Galt, where my wife and family and I had been for 11 or 12 years. We always considered those people family, and there was some changes in administration and pastoral change, and things started kind of happening. I was getting burned out, and my family, there was kind of a falling out, and even though we still considered those people family, you know, we just knew it was time to move on. And we had tried a few different churches here in Lodi, tried different places, bigger churches like Faith Community, things like that. All great churches, but you know, we just never felt at home, never felt that same feeling of what we had at our church in Galt. And coming in here, because my kids started coming to youth group here, we came in for the reindeer games, possibly. Came in here and met everyone, and right away, coming in, this is where I knew, you know, I experienced Jesus, because meeting Timothy and Tara and hearing about their vision and the things that they were trying to do here, and just, even though I was burned out with worship and burned out with tech, talking with Tara and finding out that Vintage was switching over their equipment and everything, and she had said, you know, we don't know, we're getting this new equipment and we have no idea what it is, we don't even know how to use it, but we just know that God's going to figure it out for us. And it just so happens that it's the same equipment that I have had, you know, 11 or 12 years experience working. And even though I didn't volunteer for it, because I thought, you know, I'm burned out, I'm not going to do anything. Walking away, I almost instantly felt God telling me, you know, hey, you need to be here, and you need to use your abilities that I've given you and that I've trained you for the past 12 years to help these guys out. And, you know, even though I felt burned out and everything, I decided to go ahead and just listen to that. I've learned over the years that when you hear something like that from God, you just jump in, because it's not going to stop until you accomplish it. So my wife and I started, my wife and I came to church, one Sunday. I almost immediately jumped in to help with the, sound. And yeah, once I heard Timothy, speak, I really felt connected with what I was hearing. And, you know, during that time, during that falling out period that we had, I kind of lost my way a little bit with God. Not necessarily lost my way, but I definitely lost my connection and relationship that way. I kind of stopped praying, stopped doing those types of things, just because, like I said, I was burned out. And once we started coming here, I just slowly started feeling that connection coming back. I started feeling that I knew God had me here so that I would continue my relationship with Him. As adults, we can go anywhere, right? We can read the Bible and be connected with God. But, you know, the important thing was my kids wanted to be here. My kids were the driving force for us coming here, which was always a huge thing for my family. And then once I got here, what I was hearing resonated with me and connected me and started drawing me closer to God. And that's when I knew that we needed to be here. And that's how I knew I experienced Jesus and I experienced God here. As far as community, I think, you know, having talked to Timothy and Tara, first of all, great people. I just knew that what they were doing, the vision that they had, just seemed really right on. And then when coming here for Reindeer Games, everybody was so kind and so amazing that you couldn't help but like people. and which was even though, like I said, at our old church, we had this family, those relationships, some relationships started to be damaged during that whole period. And so coming in and finding these welcoming people, and everybody was trying to include you in everything, even though they didn't even really know who you were, that's pretty amazing. And then once I had kind of signed on to help out with some of the tech and with some of the sound, I came in first day. Timothy said, "Why don't you come in and meet our worship leader?" So I came in to meet the worship leader to help change over the sound system, the soundboard. And I walk in day one, and Evan approaches me and just starts talking to me. He's like, "Hey," there was automatically a connection, being musicians, knowing that we both kind of came from the same place. It was almost like we had already kind of known each other. So, you know, there is a sense of community here. Absolutely. Everybody is so open and so kind and generous, and they're always glad to see you. You know, you walk in the doors and you just see people with a smile saying, "Hey, welcome in." You know? So I think that part is great. And, you know, then coming here, unbeknownst to me, one day, my cousin walks in, and he and his wife are like, "Hey, we're here to check out the church." And that wasn't something that I had even talked to him about or contacted him about. It just kind of happened. And you know, they are regular attendees now. So, and then I brought in a few friends of mine to come and check it out. And everybody has had really great, great responses to the church, and may potentially be going here. And I think that that's great. And that is just a perfect example of community. You know, God is creating that community, whether we know it or not. You know, He's bringing the right people together to be at the right place at the right time to make this church what it is. And Yeah, I've experienced both of those things here at Vintage, and I love it here.
We are all about Jesus here, if you did not get that. We're all about making him irresistible through our lives, and we want people to really experience him. And the other thing that we're all about here is we love food. We love to eat together. It's actually on the wall out there as one of our values, is eating together. And there's a reason for that. One commentary on the gospel says that Jesus was either going to a meal, leaving a meal, or at a meal. If you don't believe me, read one of the gospels. You'll see it. Eating together cultivates community. Its hospitality is a staple around here at Vintage Church. We are so thankful for the gospel community that is bearing fruit at Vintage Church. The next video, you're going to see how people have found community here at Vintage Church.
Hi, my name is Nancy. My husband and I have been attending Vintage Church for the last 2.5 years, and it really has been a life-changing experience for us. I feel like God has used this church to renew and restore my love for the local church. The people here have become like family to me. I treasure every connection that I've gotten to make. The warmth, the friendliness, the prayer has helped me to feel a sense of belonging and a sense of being cared for. Since coming to Vintage, I've had so many opportunities to grow and learn. I've been involved in the leadership cohort the last couple years, and that's been a super valuable experience. It's challenged me to put that extra effort into my growth and to my learning, and learning how to apply God's word and to understand leadership principles. Actually, you know, every Sunday is really an opportunity for discipleship. We get verse-by-verse teaching, and every week we get that clear call to apply what we are being taught, and the service always goes full circle to the communion table, where we are reminded of the foundation of our faith, the gospel, and get to have those heart-to-heart moments with God. I'm so thankful also for opportunities here to serve, though I get to apply the things that I've been taking in. So I'm just so thankful to be part of the body of Christ here at Vintage Church.
So about a year ago, we moved to Lodi, and we needed to find a new church. So we started going to churches on Sundays in the Lodi area, and there are great churches here in Lodi. We came to Vintage, and we really loved it. I think the first day was like 5 people came to greet us during the short greeting time.
At least
5, and we just felt really welcomed and loved. Mm. And so we left saying, you know, well, we'll pray about it and see if this is the church for us. And so we went wine tasting after church, and we saw somebody that looked familiar. And it turns out it was Evan, the worship leader from the church, and he stopped and chatted with us. And then when we left, he followed us out a little bit, and we had a really nice conversation, just a few minutes. And he was just very real with us and very friendly. And we just felt really loved and welcomed. And so as we're walking out to the car, I said to Steve, I mean, what are the chances, you know, of 90 wineries in Lodi or something, and we're going to see somebody from the church we just visited? And we just felt like that was one more confirmation that this was the place we needed to be. And we found family here, and we found community here, and people that are supportive and that pray for us and celebrate us with us when things go well, and pray with us when things are difficult. And it's wonderful to have found a church home. In Vintage.
And I would say the Bible is all about Jesus, and so is Vintage Church, not only with worshiping and communion and preaching, but just the love within the walls here, but not only within the walls, but outside in the community. That Vintage Church is very active in the community. showing Jesus' love. And we really like that.
So I was attending church at a different church here in Lodi, and it closed. It was heartbreaking. And I didn't want to go back to church. I didn't want to go through all that again. The one thing we didn't have was a kids program. So I was going to church by myself, and the grandkids were staying at the house. And then one day I decided, well, I don't need to go to church, but let's find somewhere that the grandkids can go and have a program and get involved and get to know Jesus. So we set out every Sunday looking for a church that had a good kids program. We came here, immediately felt good. It was a wonderful atmosphere. Right off the bat, I was greeted by a gal that I knew in a previous church probably 20 years ago. And people were just coming up and saying hello, and the kids went right into the kids program. And they came out that first day and they loved it. We came in the fall, probably about a year ago, and they had some things going on. They had a bingo night and chili dogs was going to happen, and movie night in the parking lot. We all sat. My daughter came, my son came, and the grandkids, and we watched a movie and ate popcorn and just fellowshipped with everybody. It was wonderful. The sermons are fantastic. I'll never forget that first series that I stayed for. I'm like, oh, I'm not going to go looking at another church right now. Chaos Dragon, that just intrigued me. I've been here ever since. The people are so loving, and the kids, even the older kids, are so good with my younger kids. They all love coming. I sit there Saturday morning, the kids will look at me. Is today church day? Nope, going tomorrow. Man. And yeah, they love it. And so do I. I wasn't trying to find anywhere, but we did. And we found more than a church. We're home. The community here is amazing. Thank you, Jesus.
All right, so our last video is going to be talking about Love Lodi, and that is one of the values on our wall. And if you're newer to Vintage, you may not have heard this, but Vintage Church actually had a line item here in our budget in 2020 called Love Lodi, because Timothy and I firmly believe that we're in this city for the city to love the city. So what Vintage Church has actually done here through Loving Lodi, that means we've supported local nonprofits. We serve the homeless and the poor, whether it's through Bread of Life or Fourth Saturday grocery distribution. We lead the way in Love Lodi as chairs. We're bringing turkeys to Lakewood Elementary or a refrigerator to Lawrence Elementary staff teachers, or supporting local businesses. We host free movie nights here in our parking lot, and we love bingo here and chili dog nights. We are all about loving Lodi practically with our hands and feet. In the next video, we asked a few of the community leaders around us to share this morning how Vintage Church has loved Lodi.
Hey, Vintage Church, so good to celebrate with you today as you're relaunching your ministries, but you guys have been doing so many amazing things for Lodi in these last several years. Since I've come, you've been very, very important in the district and in your city. There's a scripture that comes to mind. It's out of John, the first chapter, and it's paraphrased in the Message like this. The Word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. That's really our assignment as believers, is to make Jesus known where we live and to move into our neighborhood and to become irresistible and essential to our neighborhood, so that if at some point the church no longer was there, people would notice. People would say, wow, what happened? We don't have food ministry anymore in our neighborhood. We don't have National Night Out. We don't have Love Lodi, the kinds of things that you guys are investing in. So Tim and Tara and all of your leaders and congregants, congratulations. We celebrate with you this landmark and kind of this place where you're going to anchor and launch from to make a difference and be irresistible and make Jesus irresistible in your community. Love you guys. God bless you.
In the Gospel of John, chapter 13, there is this extraordinary example of the character and the behavior of Jesus, how he washes the feet of his disciples. He does it with humility and with a heart that is bent toward and given toward serving other people. Vintage Church does the same thing in many ways. It would be awkward and weird in our culture, and in fact rebuked and probably refuted, if you tried to wash someone's feet. So we have to, as Christians in the 21st century, have to look for new ways to do that. Vintage Church does that, for example, by passing out groceries in their parking lot to those families who are struggling and who have need. Vintage Church does that by gathering backpacks and distributing those to youth and children as they begin their school year. Or whether it's handing a gift card to someone who has a financial need and is happening to be passing by and knocks on the church door, or helping a family within the church with their own electric bill because they're just struggling. There's many, many ways that Vintage Church is washing the feet of people in our modern 21st century, and in doing so, they love Lodi.
Hey, Vintage Church, and this celebration, we're so pleased to be able to share a little bit about how Vintage Church loves Lodi. My name is Chris Johnson. I'm former director of Bread of Life. And we started with Bread of Life, giving food away, partnership with Vintage Church a little over a year ago. And it has been absolutely amazing. You guys have done such an incredible job of loving the people. We've turned it from a food giveaway to a ministry. And that's what you do. Every month, hundreds of people are coming to your church that would have never come to your church, but because you love them enough to volunteer, to cook for them, to play music, to love on them as they come and get food, and you treat them like your greatest customer, that's how you love Lodi. And I'm so proud to be a little part of it and the tremendous work that you guys are doing in Lodi. God bless you.
Hey, Vintage Church, Bill Morse here with the Community Service team, and I just wanted to do a shout-out thank you for being just the authentic deal here in our community. My mission is to put God's love into action by bringing people together to serve, educate, and support. That's what we do. And I'll tell you what, when we show up on Saturday mornings to serve the breakfast at Vintage Church, you're all up, you're early, you're just out there, it's just people going everywhere, setting up pop-ups and setting up tables and fixing coffee and doing everything you can to see to it that we're successful at doing what we do to partner with you to to make people feel important, loved, and wanted. Thank you, Vintage Church, for that. It is just such a blessing to serve our community with you. We're so thankful. And I just wanted to reach out and say how much of a blessing you are to me and how you make people feel important, loved, and wanted in this community. So thank you for teaming up with us. And thank you for letting us come over and just be a part of what you do in our community. God bless you, Vintage Church. We love you. This community loves you. And I'm just excited about us working together and keeping up the good work out there in the Lodi community. Love you, Vintage Church. Thank you very much for what you allow us to do. God bless you, and we'll see you out there.
Hey, I'm Glenn Barnes, pastor at First Baptist Church of Lodi. And on behalf of all your friends at First Baptist, we are just so grateful for Vintage Church. It is so cool to not only have friends and partners in ministry, but it's like really kindred spirits and people that care about our city and want to make a difference in our city. In fact, this really wise friend told me that I'm actually in the city for the city. In fact, speaking of that, I want to say just a really special word of appreciation to Timothy and Tara, not only as a fellow pastor, but as someone who was involved in leading Love Lodi for a number of different years. When Timothy and Tara came along, not only were they a breath of fresh air, but they came with vision and passion and a heart, and they've taken something that was great and turned it into something even better. And so I'm so grateful for them, not only for the work and their vision, but really for their friendship as well. They're just a role model to me in so many ways. And again, I am so grateful, not only for Timothy and Tara, but now just that whole vision that's coming out of Vintage Church. And I just love the idea of partnering together for years to come. God bless you guys as you celebrate. You really should. I hope it's a great day, and I look forward to lots of great years ahead. God bless you guys.
One of the amazing things that we get to do is just see all the good happening in our city. And we get to be at the epicenter of it in some ways through Love Lodi and also the pastor lunch and pastor prayer times. And there really is a sweet spirit of unity in our city growing and growing. And I just find it so encouraging that we could have other pastors, other community leaders speak well of one another and work together, because we can do so much more together than competing against one another or in our own silos, and which is common in ministry and in nonprofit world. And so I am super thankful for Pastor Kevin Cease, for Chris and Pastor Glenn and Bill. And I invite you to not only get involved in Love Lodi or Bread of Life or any of the other nonprofits that we have in town, but the way that we make Jesus irresistible is by receiving his love and then going out and loving others, being his hands and being his feet. And I do want to just extend a special thank you. Our mayor is here this morning, and I did invite her and just ask that say thank you for all of the warm embrace that you've given us for Love Lodi and for just being a part and seeing the good work that has happened in our city. So thank you for that. And my part, if you look on the wall out there, there's four kind of core practices that we have here at Vintage Church. We, see if I can remember them. We're rooted in Christ. No. We talk about Jesus. Gotta stay with my notes. We talk about Jesus, we eat together, we love Lodi, and that's really what our hope was with those three videos, is to kind of highlight and kind of show what's happening, that how we're doing what we say we're to do. And then my part is to talk about how we want to make Jesus irresistible. And our mission here at Vintage Church is to make Jesus irresistible in everyday life. It's this idea, it's this vision that we want to see a gospel renewal in Lodi, fruitful, flourishing lives that make Jesus irresistible. But the only way that we can make Jesus irresistible, it's really an impossible task. And we're not even sufficient for these things. Who can make Jesus irresistible? I remember one time early on in our church revitalization effort, talking with someone who was a potential leader, and they said, I don't know if I can be a leader on your team, because have you seen my life lately? Like, there's no way that I can make Jesus irresistible. I said, oh, man, I can see how that sounds. But really, the whole idea of the gospel is that we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the power is from God and not from us. And he's like, oh. And so I had to, like, change the language a little bit of our mission. And now every Sunday we say our benediction and we remind ourselves, because Jesus is irresistible, we make Jesus irresistible by his grace. We can only make Jesus irresistible because he is irresistible. Now, there are many admirable qualities about Jesus. His compassion for the poor and the vulnerable, his love for rebels and radicals, his justice, his truth. Christian ethics, if you didn't know, are making a comeback in our cultural moment. Recently, atheists and agnostics such as Richard Dawkins and even Elon Musk have claimed themselves to be cultural Christians because of the ethics of Christianity. There's really so much to love about Jesus. But I believe at the end of the day, really, at the end of the age, at the end of the consummation of redemptive history, there will be only one thing that is praised for all eternity: the grace of God. The grace of God. There's a reason that we sing a little louder when we hear Amazing Grace. There's something that hits deep when we sing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. There's a reason that at the end of that well-known hymn we sing, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. When you know and experience the grace of God, the first day, you're like, thank you, Jesus. 10,000 days later, you're like, thank you, Jesus. An infinite eon later, thank you, Jesus. Because there's no way that you can understand and experience the grace of God and not just be completely floored and wrecked with overflowing gratitude and praise to the glory of God. There is something amazing about the grace of God. And for me, it was the grace in Jesus' eyes of fire that mesmerized my attention and captivated my affections. So all of this today, all of it, it's not about me. It's not about Tara. It's not about Vintage Church. It is about the grace of God. It is all a testament to the grace of God. All of these stories and every one of your story and any future stories will only be a trophy of God's grace. Today, we're talking a little bit about the irresistible grace of Jesus. Grace is the undeserved, unearned favor of God. In the Old Testament, it's this Hebrew word hesed, where we understand the word in the English steadfast love or his loving kindness. I love the Jesus Storybook Bible. It's what we give families when they dedicate their children. And they describe this grace, this hesed, this steadfast, loyal love as never stopping, never giving up, unbreaking, always and forever love. This is the grace of God. And that word has said is always translated grace in the New Testament. You see, grace is the hero of the story of God and the narrative in Scripture. We see in John chapter 1 that Jesus came full of grace and truth. In Titus 2, it says that the grace of God appeared. It personalizes it. It puts a name tag on it. The grace of God showed up in human history, some 2,000 years ago, the grace of God embodied in the incarnate word of Jesus Christ. The grace of God went public in the life and ministry of Jesus. Today, I want you to remember three words. By the end of today, what I really want you to remember is just three words. It's grace, gratitude, and glory. Grace, gratitude, and glory. And so I know we have just a few moments together, but I need you to experience at least a little bit of what we do on a normal Sunday. And that's we stand for the reading of Scripture. And so we're going to read Paul's run-on sentence together in Ephesians chapter 1, 1 through 10. It's just one sentence. It's 10 in English in our Scriptures. But if you would stand, if you don't mind, if you're willing and you're able, would you mind standing for the reading of God's Word this morning? We're going to read Paul's sentence about the grace of God. This is the word of the Lord. Verse 3 says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will." Listen to verse 6. "To the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him, in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth." Would you pray with me this morning? Father, as we spend a few moments unpacking the grace of God, I pray right now that you would give us eyes to see, that you'd give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation to know Jesus better. And to know Jesus better is to know the grace of God better. And so we just ask you, Holy Spirit, to make much of Jesus in this time. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Two things this morning, real quick. The story of God is about the grace of God. All of redemption, did you hear it in the text, is to this end, to the praise of his glorious grace. You see, 10,000 years, having seen Jesus face to face, we are going to still praise him for the grace of God. I love what Jonathan Edwards says. He says, "Grace is but glory begun, and glory is but grace perfected." You see, when we experience Jesus, when we are born again or regenerated, when the grace of God makes us alive in him, we experience the glory of God. This is why Colossians 1:27 says that it's Christ in us, the hope of glory. But that glory is in seed form. It's the grace of God. It's grace, glory. Grace is but glory begun. And in one day, through justification and sanctification and glorification, those are all fancy Christian words. I get it. You may not understand. I don't have time to unpack it this morning. But here's the big idea. When we first meet Jesus and are made right with God, and then we become more and more like Jesus, one day when the clouds part or Jesus calls us home and God makes all things new, guess what happens? We are glorified. And the grace that begun is now full of glory and joy unspeakable. When we see grace in person and we look upon his eyes and we know his grace, we will sing for it for all eternity. The second thing is that grace is a bottomless well of life to the full. We have redemption. Did you catch that in Paul's sentence? According to the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us in Christ. Here's the thing. There's no end to God's grace. You think you've sinned too much for God? You think you have too much guilt, too much church hurt, too much shame? The grace of God knows no bottom. The grace of God is the hero of Scripture. It's grace upon grace. And so what that really means for you this morning is that you are not too far from the grace of God. You are not too injured. You are not too broken. You are not too damaged. You are not too sinful. There is a fountain of grace, and it starts at the cross of Jesus Christ. In just a few moments, we're going to take communion together where we remember the grace of God. And for me, this really hits home because, as Tara mentioned in the video, in 2018, we stepped away from ministry, and I was hurt. I was burned. Easter is my favorite Sunday. And I remember that Easter, my wife had to make me go to church. We got in a big fight the night before, and I honestly, to be vulnerable, I was contemplating just ending it all the night before. I was done. And I remember sitting in church, in my friend's church, just like this the whole day, the whole service, and just going. And then at communion, my wife looks at me and says, "Are you going to take communion?" And I said, "No, I'm not taking communion." I was so done. And then a still small whisper. And he just said, "You know, I still love you." And it just broke my heart. It warmed my heart. And I said, "I know." You see, it's the grace of God that breaks a sinner's heart. It breaks and changes a heart of stone. There is nothing else in this universe. It's what separates every single religion. Only the grace of God is championed by the gospel and Christianity. Everything else is works. All we have is grace. We can never earn it. We can never merit it. We can never do too much to somehow achieve it. It's not achieved, it's received. And you just surrender and say, "Thank you." And you look in his eyes and you hear that he loves you. And you're like, "Why do you love me? I am a wretch. I am a sinner. I am blind and I'm dead in my heart." And he says, "I love you. That's why." And it just melts you. That's the grace of God. And he loved you so much that he came, embodied his grace, the word become flesh, lived among us, lived the life that we couldn't live because we're broken, died the death that we should have died because of our sin. And then on the third day, he rose from the dead so that we could be reconciled to God the Father and have a right relationship with him, and grace could enter our life. And one day, the hope of glory, we would be like Jesus and see him face to face. So what's that third word I said? Gratitude. How do we cultivate this grace and this glory? It's really simple. Gratitude. And gratitude begins at the table. So would you pray with me this morning as we prepare for communion? Jesus, we come this morning full of gratitude, full of thanksgiving. And for the hearts that are stubborn and stone in this place, thinking that they've gone too far or some other accusation against you, God, I pray that they would be warm this morning by hearing these stories and the gospel, all grace upon grace. We didn't earn it or deserve it, but you freely give it. And we get to celebrate that at communion. We get to celebrate that as we hold in our hands the cup and the bread, and we begin to remember that you were broken for our brokenness, that you were Your blood was shed for our sin so that we could have the grace of God. Where sin increases, grace abounds all the more. There is riches of grace in Christ. I love what one acronym says, that grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. That's what we get to celebrate this morning. God's riches at Christ's expense. I don't know where your story is right now. Maybe you're not a Christian. Maybe you've never experienced the grace of God. Maybe you've never seen it in the eyes of Jesus. But today you would hear something and you would say, my heart is warmed. My heart is captivated. I want to know this Jesus. It's not achieved. It's simply received by faith. It's by grace alone we're saved. But if that's you this morning and you've never taken communion, I would invite you to come to the table and talk to someone after service and maybe over tri-tip. But here at Vintage Church, we practice open communion, which means that it's available to all who are Christians, to all who follow Christ. And if you're not a Christian, there's no shame, there's no pressure. It's just a family meal. We gather with brothers and sisters to break bread and remember God's riches at Christ's expense. So if that's you this morning, you're welcome to come. There's going to be some instructions for traffic flow this morning on the screen behind me. We believe that communion is a means of God's grace to meet us here in a profound spiritual way, to experience the irresistibility of Jesus this morning, the grace of God at the table. It is a free invitation to all who would come. All who are hungry, all who are thirsty, come and experience the riches of God's grace. It all starts at the blood of Jesus and the broken body. So as Evan begins to lead us this morning, I invite you to stand and sing, to sit and contemplate, to meditate, to pray, confess sins, whatever you need to do to respond to God. This is your moment. And then at the end, we're going to all take communion together and close with a song. But let's respond to God in this moment.
Everything changed. It's getting harder to recognize the person I was before I encountered Christ. I don't walk like I used to. I don't talk like I used to. I was washed from the inside. I was washed from the inside. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know it was the blood. Could have only been the blood. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. Ooh. I cannot explain, but nothing's more real than this, in the presence of God. Oh, what my heart experienced when my shame hit the wayside and my sin met the Most High. I was washed from the inside. I was washed from the inside. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know it was the blood. Could have only been the blood. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Could have only been the blood. Oh, could have only been your blood. Come on, won't you stand as we sing? It's never been about performance, perfection. We're striving for acceptance. Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. It's never been about deserving or earning. It's a gift that's freely given. Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Does anybody want to be holy, righteous, purified and spotless? Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Does anybody want to be worthy, forgiven, justified, really living? Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. So we say thank you, could have only been the blood. Oh. blood of Jesus. Oh, precious. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing that the blood. So with boldly confidence we sing. It's never been about performance, perfection, or striving for acceptance. Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Never been about deserving or earning. It's a gift that's freely given. Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Does anybody want to be holy, righteous, purified, and spotless? Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Does anybody want to be worthy, forgiven, justified, really living? Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood.
Amen. As we prepare for communion this morning, I just feel compelled to say this, that I feel some of us may feel like our story is over, or we're stuck in our story. That's where I felt on that Easter Sunday. But God, but the grace of God found me. And I am forever grateful. My story wasn't over. And now I get to sing my story. I get to tell my story. And I got to give glory to God. And with a grateful heart. You see, when we first experience grace, grace grows and is cultivated by gratitude. And gratitude, when we live lives of gratitude, it turns into glory. We bear fruit to the glory of God. The Bible says that God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And that's what we're doing here at communion. We're humbling ourselves and we're saying, I need help. And the grace of God found me in Jesus Christ at the cross. And so, reading this morning out of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks," there's the gratitude, "he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" So as you take the bread this morning, would you start that cultivation and give thanks? Would you show a little gratitude for your rescue and redemption story? Just spend a few moments as you eat giving thanks to God this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your blood. Thank you. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Gratitude and the gospel. These are our two anchors until he comes. We proclaim his death to our hearts. When shame sneaks up, when guilt begins to wrestle in our heart, We remember the cup. We remember the bread. We remember the gospel, and we give thanks for the grace of God. Let us drink and remember God's riches at Christ's expense this morning. Amen. Amen. Is God's grace good? Then as we go out today, I encourage you to stay standing and sing along as we remember and sing that we were made alive in Christ by the grace of God. Afterwards, Marvin's going to come up and lead us in benediction, and then we're going to feast together. And I would encourage you to share stories and get to know someone, but we're going to have a great time in just a few moments. But let's go out singing and rejoicing in the grace of God this morning.
I was dead in sin, alone and hopeless. A child of wrath I walked, condemned in darkness. But your mercy brought new life, and in your loving kindness raised me up with Christ and made me righteous. You have bought me back with the riches of your amazing grace and relentless love. I'm made alive forever with you, life forever by your grace. I'm saved by your grace, I'm saved. Lord, you are the light that broke the darkness. You satisfy my soul when I am heartless. So we sing. If ever I forget my true identity, show me who I am and help me to believe. You have bought me back with the riches of your amazing grace and relentless love. I'm made alive forever with you, life forever by your grace. I'm saved by your grace, I'm saved. See, my sin has been erased. I'll never be the same. My sin has been erased. I'll never be the same. You have bought me back with the riches of your amazing grace and relentless love. I'm made alive forever with you, life forever by your grace. I'm saved. You have bought me back with the riches of your amazing grace and relentless love. I'm made alive forever with you, life forever by your grace. I'm saved by your grace, I'm saved. By your grace, I'm saved. By your grace, I'm saved.
Well, Vintage Church, I owe my wife $5. I told her that we would be done a few minutes ago, but we are pretty close. I know we're right on it, so thank you for staying. It's a little bit longer than normal. But I am going to take this time to plug a little bit because I did see some new teenagers in here. We do youth group at 6:33 on Wednesdays, so please make your way here every Wednesday if you'd like. And I want to plug myself a little bit. There are some new faces here, and if you ever find yourself in need to pursue down the path that Pastor Timothy has been talking about this whole sermon, please come find me. I am the biblical counselor here at Vintage Church, and I'd love to sit down and help you walk through that. With that, as we leave, we will get to the benediction. If you are picking up your kids, if they're in preschool or the toddler's class, please use this door right here, okay? The founders of this church and the people that built it didn't build it for the amount of people and action that happens here, so we constantly have to coordinate through getting things done. So please make your way through that. If you are staying for food, please exit out the front door and make an immediate right and go down to our other entrance, and the line will be starting there. If you are busy or you're trying to get to a football game, please take some food. We have to-go cases, so go jump in line. Just let the ladies at the counter know that you're taking it to go, and they'll package you up to go with all the fixings and everything. So here at Vintage Church, you've heard a lot of get out in the community and make Jesus irresistible. And so at the end of every service, we say our benediction to help us remind us of what our mission at Vintage Church is, and that is to make Jesus irresistible. So I will start with Vintage Church, and then you'll jump in behind me, and then we'll go eat. All right? Vintage Church, because Jesus is irresistible. For his glory, for others' good, for our joy, by the grace of God, go and make Jesus irresistible in everyday life. Amen.